Hello everybody and welcome to the second tech video on my channel. This video will cover the installation of the first system inside the Lian Li test bench. The test bench assembly video I did previously you can find on my channel, so this time the focus will be on getting the system to run inside the test bench itself. Regarding the system, I will try to set up a Pentium 4 based system. I did try two motherboards. The first one was an ASUS P4B 266. This one I was unable to get it to boot, so I choose a P4C800, which I also had in my storage, and this one was ready to go. And now the setup of the system itself. I will start putting in a DVD drive. This is for later use when I will try to install the operating system. As you can see, it's IDE based. Back in the day, this was very popular. The main difference to SATA these days were the jumpers on the back of the device itself. Each IDE bus could connect two devices, and via these jumpers, you could define which device was recognized as a master device and which device was recognized as a slave device. You also had the option of setting the jumper to cable select. In this case, the cable connection itself did define which device was the master device and which device was recognized as slave device. In my scenario, I will only connect the CD-ROM or DVD drive to the IDE bus, so there will only be one device in the bus. Therefore, I will set the jumper to master, so that the DVD drive will be the master device on this particular bus. To install the DVD drive onto the test bench, I have to use the brackets which were included in the test bench itself. These brackets can hold up to two devices, but in my case, I will only install one DVD drive. As you can see, the installation is quite simple. You only have to mount the drive to the brackets and the brackets onto the floor of the test bench. As shown, simply position the bracket with a mounted drive so that it will cover the mounting holes on the test bench. As soon as the mounting holes are aligned, you just have to screw everything into place. Because it is quite an old system, based on a Pentium 4 processor packed onto a 478 socket which only supports DDR1 memory, I did choose an EDE-based DVD drive because SATA standard was very new at this time and not much faster than IDE standard. So this motherboard only contains two SATA ports, SATA 1 ports to be specific, and therefore I wanted to save these ports for my SSD, for my boot drive, for my hard drive. I did choose a SATA SSD drive over a classic HDD drive just for one reason. The SSD drive is a little bit faster than the HDD drive. The limiting factor on this old motherboard is not the SSD itself. It is the SATA 1 connection on the motherboard, which is, as far as I can remember, is only capable of transfer rates up to 150 megabytes per second. If we compare this with a SATA 3 port, which is used today, we see that we did come a long way, because mother and SATA 3 standard can handle up to 600 megabytes per second, which is 4 times faster than SATA 1, which is installed on this motherboard. But keep in mind, this is just around 17 megabytes more than the latest ATAPI 7 standard used on IDE based devices, which was capable of transfer rates up to 133 megabytes per second. So the conclusion is, yes, the SATA port is faster than the IDE based connection, but only by 17 megabytes. But even these 17 megabytes will make a big difference in, for example, loading times or even when it comes to setup windows. Therefore, I will try to squeeze out every last drop of hard drive performance that I can. As you can see, the DVD drive, which will be connected via the IDE bus, is installed, as well as the SATA drive, which will be plugged into the SATA port and later be used as our primary boot drive. The next step is the installation of the power supply. I did choose a 500 watt power supply, not because the system will consume that much power. For example, systems back in the day did use power supplies with up to 350 watts, so 500 watt is more than enough for our system here. But this is a bench. I will try to set up classic SLI based systems in the future as well. Therefore, I did choose a bigger power supply and more modern power supply so that I will be able to install other systems in the future as well without having to change the power supply. Now let's take a closer look at the first motherboard I try. It's the P4B 266 from ASUS. It is capable of connecting up to 5 PCI, not PCIe expansion cards. It has an AGP Pro slot for installing graphic cards, and it also has 3 DDR1 slots for installation of memory. The heart of this system is the socket 478, which will allow us to install Celeron-based or Pentium 4-based processor cores. The next step is to prepare a CPU cooler. This is also an old piece of hardware which I had laying around, and as you can see, it is still some old thermal paste on it. I will now remove the old paste, clean the base plate of the cooler, so that it is ready for a new clean thermal paste application. Removing old thermal paste is easy. Just grab a towel, which is soft, or a kitchen paper, soak it up with CPU cleaner and rub off the old paste. There are different ways to remove old paste depending on the condition of the paste. If the paste is very old and dry, like in my case, I prefer to use the soaked towel or paper right away. If the paste would be more liquid-like, I would remove the first bunch of paste with a dry run, so just a towel or just the kitchen paper, without soaking it up first. Now we need to install the motherboard on the bench. Each board uses different mounting points depending on the board standard. For example, the P4B266 and the P4C800 boards, which I use in this video, are both ATX-based motherboards and use the same mounting locations. You can identify these locations by either looking inside your case. Some manufacturers write little notes beside the holes, so you know which holes are for which motherboard standard. Or you could just grab your motherboard, hold it on top of your board, or hold it on top of your case, or for example in my case over the bench, and look which holes you have to use to mount the board onto your bench or inside your case. After you did identify the holes to use, you have to install the little motherboard standoffs so that the board won't sit flat on your case base plate, or in my case on the base plate of my test bench. Now just simply screw in the motherboard to the installed standoffs and apply some new thermal paste onto your CPU. Depending on the CPU socket type, you need to be careful during the installation. Modern Intel CPUs uses LGA based sockets, on which the pins are located inside the CPU socket itself. But back in the day, Intel did use PGA based sockets, on which the CPU itself carried the pins. So therefore, you have to be very careful not to bend or rip off pins during the installation of such a CPU. So let's do a quick recap. I told you of two type of CPU sockets, LGA and PGA, and that in this board we have a PGA socket. A PGA socket can be identified by the socket itself. It only contains holes for the pins mounted on the back of the CPU, which will be placed in the PGA socket of the motherboard. The LGA socket has the pins on the motherboard, and the CPU only has some connection spots on the back. So this is the big difference. PGA has the pins on the CPU, and LGA has the pins inside the socket itself. As you can see, meanwhile I did finish the CPU assembly, put on some new thermal paste, as well as installed and connected the CPU cooler itself. The next installation step is putting in one stick of DDR1 memory. This board only supports single channel DDR1 memory, so one stick is totally fine for the initial boot up. The next step is to connect the ATX 24 pin power connector to the motherboard, and also plug in the 4-pin connector for the CPU power supply. Now that I have installed the base components, I will install the graphics card. I choose an old Matrox PCI-based graphics card because I just wanted to boot up the system for the first time and did not care about performance. Later on, I will be switching to a different, more powerful card. So as soon as the card is installed onto the PCI slot, I will connect the basic stuff like keyboard, power and VGA cable so that the display output is ready. With all the components and connections ready, I just need to connect the power switch of my bench to the motherboard so that I could actually start the system. You could also just shorten the pins on the motherboard, but I prefer to have a real start button. So sadly, the P4B266 won't boot or post. Nothing happened, not even the CPU cooler was spinning. I got a green light on the motherboard, which usually indicates everything is okay, but in this case the system just won't start. I did try it a couple of more times, but the system refused to boot up or start. So I did change to plan B and installed the P4C800, a little bit newer generation motherboard with already supporting DDR1 dual channel configuration, so even more retro speed. I did skip to show you the installation of the P4C800 board because it is quite simple or identical to the installation of the P4B266. And this time it was booting right away. Now that I knew that the board was fine, I did secure the board properly and screwed it into the test bench. I also did switch the CPU mounting bracket from the P4B266 over to the P4C800 because at the first run I just placed the CPU cooler on top of the CPU without any bracket or mounting it properly. This is nothing I would recommend, but for the first quick boot up test, it's absolutely fine. And here's just another look of the P4B266, which wasn't booting. Now we're in the process of getting the system to run. Because the system was laying around on my or in my basement for quite a long time, the battery for the BIOS was completely drained, so the BIOS was lost. And the system was booting, but it was showing that there was no BIOS information present anymore. So due to the fact that this is an old system, I needed to grab one of my old floppy drives and prepared a floppy disk with a new BIOS version or with a BIOS to flash onto the board. So here, as you can see, I installed an old floppy disk, connected it to the motherboard, and now I just needed another floppy drive to my regular PC. But nowadays, the modern PCs don't support any internal floppy drives anymore. But luckily I had an old USB-based floppy drive, which I could connect to my regular PC, go to the ASUS website, download the BIOS flash file, put it onto the floppy disk and installed it here on the test bench to recreate the BIOS for this motherboard. The very nice thing on this ASUS motherboard is that if you inserted an empty floppy disk, it showed you what file name it was expecting. So as I mentioned, I went to the ASUS website, searched for that motherboard, went to the driver section, downloaded the boot ROM and put it onto the floppy disk, inserted it, booted up again. And now you hear the sweet sound of floppy disk working. It did recognize the ROM file and it starts reading it and flashing it onto the BIOS, and the system will be ready to rock in a couple of minutes. My advice to you is, if you're trying to get some of your old hardware back online and ready to rock, you should definitely grab yourself and use USB-based floppy drive so that you can copy any files from the internet to a floppy disk and then use it on your old system. And as shown here, it is essentially to get an old system back online, because most of these systems will have empty batteries. And you also should get some of these round classic batteries to renew them in your systems. So the finishing or the copy process is now finished, and I will reboot the system and we will see a post screen with all the information of the installed hardware. And we can go into the BIOS to do a quick initial setup of all the components, like defining which is your boot drive, which boot order do you have, and a couple of other things. Because back in the days, there was a kind of resource shortage, and my best way was always to disable all the ports that you don't need. So for example, serial port or printer port. This would be more easily than if you're inside Windows and would like to install drivers or specific drivers for sound cards or graphics cards. It's, in my experience, better to have less interfaces enabled so you won't get any issues with IRQ overlapping, all that stuff, which was really, really annoying and a lot of the times present back in the days. So here inside the BIOS, the first thing I will do is set up the date and time. I will prepare the current date and the current time, just that later on, if I'm inside Windows, the time is correct. And the second step that I will do is, like I told earlier, disable some of the interface ports which I don't need. In my case, I will disable the onboard LAN because I'm not going to connect the system to the internet. And I'm also going to disable some of the other external interfaces, like here serial port and parallel port. And then I will just do and go through the BIOS settings, have a quick overview of the BIOS options, because I did not run the system for a very long time. Here in power management, I do activate the system thermal monitor. So because I'm using a stock Intel cooler and I'm not sure how good it is, and because I will later on do some benchmarking and stuff, I just will ensure that my CPU won't get baked. So I set the thermal monitor and the throttling. Then I save the configuration. The system will reboot and we will see the classic please insert a boot device screen, because I'm currently don't have connected a CD-ROM drive with Windows or anything else on it. So this was the first installation of a system inside my test bench. This little floppy disk saved my ass to get the BIOS up and running. I hope you enjoyed the video and will be back for the next part, in which I will install Windows and some classic games. So stay tuned, have fun, see you soon, bye!
Thank you.